Yeah, good morning, everybody. So great to see you. You are the chosen ones. You came out the day after Christmas. Well done. I hope you all had a lovely Christmas with lots of good food, good people to share it with, and if not, just some real good time to rest and relax and to think of all the good things that happened. It is amazing that we are here again, ending a year out, and COVID-19 is still here. I was actually thinking about when last time I spoke about it, because we were all still shocked. It's like, oh my goodness, it's still here. And another year went. It's amazing. So at this time of year, there's lots of magazine and news articles about what happened over the year. It's a reflective time. Everybody's thinking about what was happening. And usually it's what famous people got married, who died, sporting achievements or latest films, weather disasters, or world events that have happened. And often when I read these or watch them, I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot that happened. I forgot that happened this year. So it's a good way to remember what the year entailed. As we're coming to the end of 2021, we should take a look back ourselves. We should take some time to think about what happened over the last year for us as Christians. Can you see any growth in yourself? Can you see any breakthrough of things you've been praying for? Can you see any answers to prayers that you've prayed? Do you think you have more knowledge about Christ and what he has done in your life? Do you feel you know him more or more intimately? Have any of your circumstances changed or improved? It is time to take stock. Often as we come to the end of a year, we start to focus on what the next year will bring. We come to it with so much hope. Next year's going to be better. Which is absolutely crazy. To think the end of one month and the beginning of the next month is going to be so radically different. Especially when you haven't done anything to change. Especially when exactly what you did the day before will be what you do the next day. We need to take a look back so that we can see what needs to be changed to make a difference for next year. The changes that we need to do so that the next year we can go, wow, yeah, things happened and now I have more hope because I can see the difference. When we look back, we need to ask, did we use our gifts, our time, our talents more than we did the year before? Can we see growth in our relationships? Can we see we have obeyed God's leading more than we've ever done before? Are we spending more time in his word or spending more meaningful time in his word? The point of looking back is not just to have fond memories. Obviously, that's a part of it. And sometimes looking back can be painful because of sad events that could have happened. But as a Christian, we should look back to see where we have done more of the things we have learned and heard about of our Lord. What did you learn this last year? What have I learned? When I look back, I think about the sermon series that we have done as a church. The first is, I'm hoping this reminds you all, the journey. This was a study about Abraham and his faith journey. We found out and had examples of where we could and should walk in that same faith journey. Then we had all in. We focused on what it would be like to be all in with the Lord, with everything, our time, our talents, our gifts, our finances, and so on. To be fully in with the Lord. Then in May, we did Listen, validate and heal. It was during May that Pastor Dan preached his final sermon at that First Christian Church. And it was a powerful message about what was most important, what was truly valuable to us. Then we did a new life. We went through the book of Colossians, looking for the new for our lives, how we can trust God more and to keep growing us. And then we did Blueprints. Blueprints was a series reminding us of the fundamentals and the foundations that we needed as Christians. And there was a lot of how-to questions all the way through it. And then we went through the book of Mark, looking for good news. Good news of how we have been chosen and how we have value. And then we finished off the year with the promise. And of course, the promise is Jesus. As I remind you of past year's sermons, is it making you think about areas that you were hoping to grow in? Or a change that you were feeling like, oh, I think I'm going to do this. Did you take some of the lessons and change some things in a way that you see the Lord or in the way you see yourself? Did you see any of these improvements? It is very easy to come to church and to sit and hear a great sermon, not that I'm bragging, to hear a sermon and then to feel inspired and, oh, I'm going to do that, and then to walk out and forget everything. I want us to ponder more. I want us to think about more about what we hear. It's great to take notes, but I want us to feel, when we feel challenged, I want us to feel challenged, and then when we feel challenged, to actually do something about pursuing that challenge that's inside of us. And you know, today in 2021, there are no excuses. You don't have to take notes. You can just go home and rewatch and rewatch and rewatch until it's inside of you. This is an advantage that we have today. As we're at the end of 2021, let us start to contemplate the year ahead. What is it that you want to improve? How do you want to grow more? And how do you want to get to know God better? It is time to take stock. Over the last month or so, when I knew I was going to be preaching or making this series, I was asking God, what would you like me to speak on, God? And the only scripture that kept coming back was in Matthew 7:7-8. And it says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. The today's sermon series is called Ask and Listen. I just want to say thank you, Lord, for being here. Thank you for your words. This is your sermon. Just thank you, Lord. Yeah, in Jesus' name, amen. So this week, we're going to focus on the ask, and it shall be given to you. There are a lot of scriptures that talk about asking God for things and how important it is. It must be important because how often it's in there. God's ultimate goal is to be in conversation with us all. His primary reason for telling us to ask for everything we need or want is to build a relationship with Him. God is a family man. He is the ultimate father. And He wants intimacy with us. We are His children. And He calls us and He asks us, ask me for everything. He wants us to be fully reliant on Him. What we must remember is we have all been designed and created by God. Then He allows us to choose whether we want to go with Him, whether we want Him in our lives or to go on this journey with Him. And even when we don't choose Him, He spends our whole life calling us, waiting for us to come back to his arms. Just like the father of the prodigal son, the father let the son go. He didn't try to stop him. In fact, not only did he not try to stop him, he gave him his whole inheritance. And the boy left. And then the father started watching and waiting until his return. But the boy was free to go. The father let him go. God is patient. He will wait for whenever and whatever circumstances make us return to him. He is just waiting and watching. Three times in John, Jesus tells us to ask the Father for all things. John 14, 13 to 14. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. There doesn't seem to be any restrictions on what we can ask for, whatever and anything. That pretty much covers it all. The only stipulation seems to be asking in his name. And then John 15, 7 says, If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Now it is suggested we should remain in him and his words. The Bible. Here is a clue of how to communicate with the Father by reading his words that he has given us. The Bible is the way that we can find out and what he wants to give us and to know him more. He says that we can ask whatever and it will be done. And if you read on in that chapter, you'll see it talks about the Father's love. John 15, 9 to 11. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. Jesus is wanting us to receive the Father's love to the same extent that he experiences it, the way he receives it. He wants us to be filled with complete joy. I like the sound of that. I could do with a bit of complete joy. John 16, 23 says, on that day, you will no longer ask me anything. Very truly I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. The theme running through this is whatever you ask, ask in Jesus' name. So what can we ask for? Are there any restrictions? Can we ask for $1 million? Can we ask for a new house, a new job? Well, Jesus says we can ask for anything. So I would say there's nothing you can't ask for. You can ask for all of those things. God would not be a good father if he just said yes to it all. Just like us, when our children ask for things, we don't give them everything because often they're not ready. Often it would be detrimental to them, and often it's not what they need. God is exactly the same with us. He loves us so much that he doesn't say yes to everything. And sometimes his no is not yet, wait. But the point is, we can ask for anything. He can handle it all. He doesn't care the bigness of what you're asking for. It's just important that we ask. We must speak to our Heavenly Father. We must understand he is our Father and he has great things in store for us to have and to do. Psalm 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. He wants to give us what we desire. He has great plans for us. In 1 John 5:14 to 15 it says, "This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he will hear us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we asked of him." It seems we should have confidence or faith that God is listening to us and he is waiting for us to ask so that he can give us what we desire. Does that mean we should wake up every morning with our list of wants and desires? As long as we believe he can do it, it's all good. As I said at the beginning, God is wanting a relationship. He wants dialogue with us. Imagine if you had a friend that just called you every day with a list of things they wanted or needed you to get for them. No conversation, just a list. I'm not sure you'd be friends for very long. We desire connection with our friends. When we have connection and love, we give out of a desire to show them our affection, to show them how much we love them. And God is the same. He gives out of that desire to show you how much he cares, how much he loves, and how much he desires for that closeness. God wants us to be involved with him. He doesn't want to be controlling us. He just wants it for inclusion with him. It's all about relationship. When we're in a conversation with someone, it wouldn't be good to have one person talking. That wouldn't be called a conversation, it would be called a monologue. And actually looked up monologue. A monologue is a speech delivered by one person. I hope this doesn't count as a monologue, because it says, "A long one-sided conversation that makes you want to pull your hair out from boredom." So I really hope this isn't a monologue. So how are we to go about asking God for whatever we want? What has been missing so far from what I have mentioned? Yes, we should ask. But just like any conversation, it's just as important to listen. When we speak to God, we must be ready to listen to. We need to hear what his answers to our requests are. We need to be expecting him to give us an answer. How can we go about working with him if we don't know what it is his reply is and what he's asking of us? Jeremiah 29:12 says, "Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you." When we ask, we need to wait. We need to wait to hear him responding to our wants and our desires. He does answer us, but do we have an ear to listen? Or do we just come with our list and then go about our day? Then at the end of the day, complain that nothing was done. This is hardly how we should treat our Creator, friend, and Father. In Jeremiah 6:16, it says, "This is what the Lord says, stand at the crossroads and look. Ask for the ancient paths. Ask where the good way is, and walk in it, and you will find rest for your souls." Notice the scripture says, ask where the good way is. If we don't wait for an answer, how will we know? How will we find rest? If we're not prepared to listen to the instructions of what is the best way for us. If you read in 2 Samuel, David asks of the Lord and lots of times about how to win the wars, and God gives him strategies of how to rout the enemy and win the battle with for the Israelites. So when we ask, we must remember we are in a conversation and we must wait for an answer. We must listen for the small voice of God to speak to us. As we hear him, we must obey what he suggests to us. Just like when David inquired of the Lord about what to do against the enemy, God instructed David in how he was to go about beating them. And each time there was something different. God didn't just take the enemy away. He told David how to do it. Then it was up to David to obey what he had heard. And that is how he beat them. On a note about the still small voice of God, you're not going to hear it when you're busy, when you're distracted, when, like me, you're trying to do at least two things at once. You must stop and engage with the Lord. Today we're often speaking to people and they're on their phones at the same time, and although they can answer the questions or they can respond correctly, they're not fully involved in the conversation. They're missing out on the fullness of your relationship. And it's exactly the same with God. If we're distracted, if we're half-hearted, we're missing out on the fullness of God and all he has for us. What does the Bible say we should ask for? In James 1:5 it says, if any of you lack wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Wisdom is a prize to be had. We should be asking for wisdom every time we talk to God. If we have wisdom, everything we do will go better. Wisdom is a priceless free gift. Having wisdom will not only help you with everything you do in your day-to-day, but it will also help you of what to ask for. In Luke 11:13, it says, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Here's what else we should be asking for: the Holy Spirit. Again, a priceless free gift. When we rely on the Holy Spirit, we get the power and the knowledge, the strategies, and the help we need to live our lives, to get our dreams and desires. James 1:6 says, but when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. And it says the same in Mark 11:24. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours. We must believe. We must have faith that God will do it. We have to have faith that God will answer us, that he can do whatever we ask for, and that he wants to answer our prayers. Reading in James 4:1-3 is quite an eye-opener, a little scary. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your own pleasures. Uh-oh. This is a scary verse. It says we kill, quarrel and fight when we don't get what we want. It makes me think of two-year-old tantrums. Up to this point, he says we can ask for anything, all the desires of your heart. But in this passage, he points out when we ask with wrong motives, when we are selfish, it leads to war amongst us. He's letting us know we should be asking for the desires of our hearts to serve others. He knows when we use our gifts that he has given us for helping and serving others, we receive the desires fully. We have complete joy. We have purpose. He can trust us. He can give us more. We can ask for things that are just for us, and he'll give them to us with our right motive. But our goal is to copy Jesus and to serve those around us. I'm just going to go, this might seem a bit off topic, but the last few weeks I felt God has reminded me over and over while I was preparing this sermon, and I feel like I'm supposed to speak about it. I felt God reminding me to be alert, sober, and fully awake. Not in slumber. And I've been feeling it isn't just for me, I feel like it is for the church. Romans 13:11 says, and do this, understanding the present time, the hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. As we take stock of last year, maybe it's time to take a serious look at not just last year, but also maybe the past 5 years. Have you been sitting back, not really doing anything? Are you so comfortable in your marriage, your work, your life, that there is nothing pushing you to improve the status quo? Things are okay. So there's no real reason to rock the boat or to change. I've had a few conversations with people that are going through a tough time, and often it's a shock of devastation, and that shocks them into action. I am feeling that it's time for us all to wake up and to see what God has been asking us to do. It's time to grow up. It's time to take what we have been hearing and do something with it. In Revelation 3:15-16, it says, I know your deeds. You are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Sorry, there's a fire engine just pulling up. Don't get distracted. It's okay. He stopped outside the church, Mark. Sorry. And now he's driving. Sorry. So we distracted. Don't be lukewarm. Don't be on fire. Don't be lukewarm. He would prefer you to make mistakes and even be away from him rather than that. Better to be awake doing something rather than doing nothing or being scared to step out. Are you asleep? Wake up before you are shaken awake. Come out of the shadows. It's not about doing, it's about being. When I think about my life over the past years, I realized I was asleep for way too much of it. Then a painful drama happened, and suddenly I was shaken, fully awake. I was clinging to the Lord, desperately reading his word for help, looking for healing. I was shaken awake, and it wasn't a good feeling. I was relying on things being just okay. I didn't even need God in those areas because they were okay. But once the shock hit me, I understood I had been asleep. Smugly thinking I didn't need to work
on these parts of my life. In fact, I think I even bragged about a few of them. And I've been speaking to others who describe the same feeling. God had to shake them awake to step into what he's been asking of them for years. Can I implore you to take stock, to not wait until you are shaken, but to take action now? Start by asking God for his help, his guidance. Ask him what it is that you have been taking for granted. Where are you sleeping? What is it that he has been warning you to do with the gifts he has given you? Don't wait for the new year. Don't wait to be shaken. Start now. It's easy to get stirred up by a message, but I really want you to think about this. What will it take to wake you up? Honestly, you don't want that to happen. Better open your eyes now and start taking action. Start taking action to make the next year's 5 years, sorry, the next year and hopefully the next 5 years more meaningful, more effective, more satisfying, more fulfilling. God has great plans for you. It's time to find out what they are and go for it. So that next year won't just be, I hope the new year's better, I haven't done anything, I hope it's got better. It will be, I've seen changes this year and I'm looking forward to next year because I'm going to continue on this path of change, of promises, of deliverances, of power, of freedom, of healings, the desires of my heart being fulfilled, my prayers being answered, and I can look at my church and see the same in the people that are here. So take stock of what you would like to be different. Ask God for his leading and his answers. Wake up and start really diving into God and his word. Start putting into action all you've been given over the years and watch what he does when you ask and when you listen. I'm going to pray and it will be the end of the sermon, the service. So I just want to say thank you for coming. But once I pray, the service is ended and you're free to go. Lord, I pray that I can see the changes in my life, that I will see the changes in my church family life, that I will see the changes in my own family life in the year and the years to come. And thank you, Holy Spirit, that we can ask for your freedom. We can ask for your power. We can ask for your wisdom, Lord. And I pray as we say goodbye to 2021, we really do take stock of our lives. And I pray that this will give us hope for the next years to come. Lord, I pray for each and every person here and online. I just thank you for them in Jesus' name. Amen. You're free to leave.